watchful and final debate. It's kind of like watching a porn. You know, we're all kind of just waiting eagerly to see what happens next. What kind of rabbit is Donald Trump going to pull out of his hat? Is he going to mention the new woman who's accused Billy Boy, ought not have sexual relations with that woman, of another sexual assault that the mainstream media is just kind of throwing under the rug? Will Hillary Clinton collapse live on camera? Will she lose her shit once again and be wheelbarrowed out of the debate stage in Las Vegas, Nevada? Should be very interesting tonight. I want to thank all of you for tuning in. If you thought you were going to get Anderson Cooper or Bill O'Reilly or Don Lemon, or perhaps you thought you were tuning into the Clinton News Network or Faux News or maybe MSNBC, well, you've just been hijacked by the alternative media. And my name is Christopher Green. Welcome to the show. I'm kind of like coming out today. No, I'm not gay, although that would probably be interesting and get a lot of views. But you see, I'm a thought criminal. It's been really hard to say it. I've been living with it my entire life. You see, I think critically. I don't trust my government. I don't trust Barack Obama. And I certainly don't trust the Benghazi gate lying whore that makes up Hillary Clinton. Nor do I trust the propaganda bullshit mainstream media. You see, I think critically. I'm a thought criminal. There, I've said it, world. I'm a thought criminal. I think for myself. I'm kind of like what our founding fathers were. Revolutionaries. People that thought for themselves. That actually gave a shit when they founded the country. And tried to do something great by establishing an idea for liberty and freedom. So I want to welcome you tonight, if you're new, and, well, we've hijacked the mainstream media. I'm not going to apologize. We did it for a reason, because a lot of you out there are just dumb. The wool has been pulled over your eyes, and you can't see the truth. Well, tonight, we'll sit back and we'll enjoy. It looks like we've got 2 minutes and 53 seconds to witness, as long as the world's still standing and a nuke doesn't go off, which we're going to have a nuclear war, if you didn't know that, thanks to Hillary Rotten Clinton, who wants a no-fly zone in Syria, who also created and founded ISIS, along with Barack Obama, the founder and commander-in-chief himself. You're about to witness the shit hit the fan. I said this in the first presidential debate that we hosted, and the second presidential debate that we hosted that went viral, by the way. It's kind of like a rocket launch. Tick, tock, tick, tock. If you're one of our regular subscribers, thank you so much for tuning in and everything that you do for our platform. Many of you have been with me since the very beginning as we built this from the basement. The underground. Again, shh. Don't tell your mother. It's a secret. It's dangerous what we do here. You see, you might get ideas of your own. You might also start to distrust the indoctrination system that makes up America today. It's very dangerous, folks. Please give me a thumbs up on YouScrew if you can hear me, if you can also visually see me, and you're also able to give us a comment or a question in the comment box. That would help us out. It would kind of give us the green light on the operations here at Alternative Media Television. Again, broadcasting from the underground and hijacking the bullshit mainstream media. 56 seconds. 55. 54, 53, 52, 51. When we launch off, also give me an audio check on the actual stream that we're pulling from C-SPAN, because they're the only ones that won't, well, boot us. Yeah, you see, the truth is dangerous, and CNN and Google, the monopoly that it is, will just try to shut it down. So Again, we're hijacking the mainstream media, folks. So if you'd like, go out and share it with your friends and family. Share it to the world. Like it. Favorite it. Tweet it. Facebook it. You screw it. Right now, as long as this stream is up, we'll be broadcasting the full live debate in its absolute glory and entirety tonight, Wednesday, October 19th, 2016. We've got approximately 5 seconds left, 4 seconds left, 3 seconds left, 2 seconds left. I'm waiting, C-SPAN. Again, when the stream does go live, give me an audio check. Give me a thumbs up in the comment section. Let me know we're properly hijacking the mainstream media. Go to your comments now. Stream should be up very, very shortly, folks. Okay, yeah, looks like we've got thumbs up, at least for now. See a few comments here hitting the rounds. Let me know, folks, if you've got any audio at the moment. I think they're just kind of bringing us in and introducing the debate. I can hear some faint background. I think it's supposed to be that way here at the moment. Let me know as soon as you get a good audio signal on this third corrupt and rigged presidential debate. Thank you, mainstream media. We really appreciate you rigging everything. And you too, George Soros. Our appreciation for owning the voting machines in 16 of the states here in America, including battleground states like Florida. This is all truth and fact. Look it up for yourself if you don't believe me. In Arizona, our home state. Thank you so much. And oh, by the way, we also know that you donate to Hillary Clinton's super PAC in the amounts of millions of dollars and have helped to destabilize not just the Middle East, but also through massive engineered migration, the United States of America. And also, by the way, you fund, according to you, Black Lives Matter. So thank you so much for the act of destabilization and raping and pillaging of not just global economies through currency manipulation, but also now rigging our elections. We really appreciate it, George Soros, and thank you for your contribution to the Hillary Clinton rotten campaign that it is. You've done a great job, sir. You're so old, it almost looks like you're going to die right now. Maybe you're even watching right now, but you're an ugly son of a bitch. I don't know how old you are, but you're extremely, extremely old. Okay, here we go. University of Nevada, Las Vegas. Las Vegas, City of Lights. Says the debate starts in 59 seconds. Of course, we will be doing another audio check in a moment when this starts. Want to make sure all of you guys get a good, clear stream. We are streaming in 1080p. Yeah, that's HD. Not in 4K. That'd be too much of an overload for YouTube to handle. Yep, see a lot of comments. See a lot of you fill in the room. Make sure to share this. Get it out everywhere, guys. Like it and favorite it if you dare. Or don't. Or don't. Okay, so I think the audio is going to turn up on this feed. You can hear me, I'm assuming. But on the feed, that's what I'm interested in knowing. When that starts in approximately 10 seconds or so, according to what I see on our lovely, beautiful screen. Debate will, of course, be lasting approximately an hour and a half, completely commercially free.
Good evening from the Thomas and Mack Center at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. I'm Chris Wallace of Fox News. And I welcome you to the third and final of the 2016 presidential debates between Secretary of State Hillary Clinton and Donald J. Trump. This debate is sponsored by the Commission on Presidential Debates. The commission has designed the format, six roughly 15-minute segments with two-minute answers to the first question, then open discussion for the rest of each segment. Both campaigns have agreed to those rules. For the record, I decided the topics and the questions in each topic. None of those questions has been shared with the commission or the two candidates. The audience here in the hall has promised to remain silent. No cheers, boos, or other interruptions so we and you can focus on what the candidates have to say. No noise except right now, as we welcome the Democratic nominee for president, Secretary Clinton, and the Republican nominee for president, Mr. Trump. Secretary Clinton, Mr. Trump, welcome. Let's get right to it. The first topic is the Supreme Court. You both talked briefly about the court in the last debate, but I want to drill down on this because the next president will almost certainly have at least one appointment and likely or possibly two or three appointments, which means that you will, in effect, determine the balance of the court for what could be the next quarter century. First of all, where do you want to see the court take the country? And secondly, what's your view on how the Constitution should be interpreted? Do the founders' words mean what they say, or is it a living document to be applied flexibly according to changing circumstances?
Well, Hillary's idea is to rape it.
In this segment, Secretary Clinton, you go first. You have 2 minutes.
Thank you very much, Chris, and thanks to UNLV for hosting us. You know, I think when we talk about the Supreme Court, it really raises the central issue in this election, namely, what kind of country are we going to be? What kind of opportunities will we provide for our citizens? What kind of rights will Americans have? And I feel strongly that the Supreme Court needs to stand on the side of the American people, not on the side of the powerful corporations and the wealthy. For me, that means that we need a Supreme Court that will stand up on behalf of women's rights, on behalf of the rights of the LGBT community, that will stand up and say no to Citizens United, a decision that has undermined the election system in our country because of the way it permits dark, unaccountable money to come into our electoral system.
Like into your pocketbook.
I have major disagreements with my opponent about these issues and others that will be before the Supreme Court. But I feel that at this point in our country's history, it is important that we not reverse marriage equality, that we not reverse Roe v. Wade, that we stand up against Citizens United, we stand up for the rights of people in the workplace, that we stand up and basically say, the Supreme Court should represent all of us. That's how I see the court, and the kind of people that I would be looking to nominate to the court would be in the great tradition of standing up to the powerful, standing up on behalf of our rights as Americans. And I look forward to having that opportunity. I would hope that the Senate would do its job and confirm the nominee that President Obama has sent to them. That's the way the Constitution fundamentally should operate. The president nominates, and then the Senate advises and consents or not, but they go forward with the process.
Secretary Clinton, thank you. Mr. Trump, same question. Where do you want to see the court take the country, and how do you believe the Constitution should be interpreted?
Well, first of all, it's great to be with you, and thank you, everybody. The Supreme Court, it's what it's all about. Our country is so it's just so imperative that we have the right justices. Something happened recently where Justice Ginsburg made some very, very inappropriate statements toward me and toward a tremendous number of people, many, many millions of people that I represent. And she was forced to apologize, and apologize she did. But these were statements that should never, ever have been made. We need a Supreme Court that, in my opinion, is going to uphold the Second Amendment and all amendments, but the Second Amendment, which is under absolute siege. I believe if my opponent should win this race, which I truly don't think will happen, we will have a Second Amendment, which will be a very, very small replica of what it is right now.
Destroyed.
But I feel that it's absolutely important that we uphold because of the fact that it is under such trauma. I feel that the justices that I am going to appoint, and I've named 20 of them, the justices that I'm going to appoint will be pro-life. They will have a conservative bent. They will be protecting the Second Amendment. They are great scholars in all cases, and they are people of tremendous respect. They will interpret the Constitution the way the founders wanted it interpreted. And I believe that's very, very important. I don't think we should have justices appointed that decide what they want to hear.
Notice how Hillary is wearing white again. She's trying to look like, you know, she's not Satan.
So important, the Constitution, the way it was meant to be. And those are the people that I will appoint.
Mr. Trump, thank you. We now have about 10 minutes for an open discussion. I want to focus on two issues that, in fact, by the justices that you name, could end up changing the existing law of the land. First is one that you mentioned, Mr. Trump, and that is guns. Secretary Clinton, you said last year, and let me quote, the Supreme Court is wrong on the Second Amendment. And now, in fact, in the 2008 Heller case, the court ruled that there is a constitutional right to bear arms, but a right that is reasonably limited. Those were the words of the judge, Antonin Scalia, who wrote the decision. What's wrong with that?
Well, first of all, I support the Second Amendment. I lived in Arkansas for 18 wonderful years. I represented upstate New York. I understand and respect the tradition of gun ownership. It goes back to the founding of our country. But I also believe that there can be and must be reasonable regulation. Because I support the Second Amendment doesn't mean that I want people who shouldn't have guns to be able to threaten you, kill you or members of your family. And so when I think about what we need to do, we have 33,000 people a year who die from guns. I think we need comprehensive background checks, need to close the online loophole, close the gun show loophole. There's other matters that I think are sensible, that are the kind of reforms that would make a difference, that are not in any way conflicting with the Second Amendment. You mentioned the Heller decision, and what I was saying that you referenced, Chris, was that I disagreed with the way the court applied the Second Amendment in that case. Because
anyone that doesn't support
what the District of Columbia was trying to do was to protect toddlers from guns. And so they wanted people with guns to safely store them. And the court didn't accept that reasonable regulation, but they've accepted many others. So I see no conflict between saving people's lives and defending the Second Amendment.
Let me bring Mr. Trump in
here. Well, we save people's lives by keeping them armed. That's the only thing that stops the terrorism.
Got millions of votes on questions to ask here, and this was, in fact, one of the top questions that they got. How will you ensure the Second Amendment is protected? You just heard Secretary Clinton's answer. Does she persuade you that while you may disagree on regulation, that in fact she supports a Second Amendment right to bear arms?
Well, the D.C. versus Heller decision was very strongly, and she was extremely angry about it. I watched. I mean, she was very, very angry when upheld. And Justice Scalia was so involved, and it was a well-crafted decision. But Hillary was extremely upset, extremely angry, and people that believe in the Second Amendment and believe in it very strongly were very upset with what she had to say.
Well, let me bring in Secretary Clinton. Were you extremely upset?
Well, I was upset because, unfortunately, dozens of toddlers injure themselves, even kill people with guns.
Bringing up
because, unfortunately, not everyone who
now, terrorists kill people that don't have guns to defend themselves with.
Precautions. But there's no doubt that I respect the Second Amendment, that I also believe there's an individual right to bear arms. That is not in conflict with sensible, common sense regulation. And,
gun control, you
know,
you
look,
mean?
I understand that Donald's been strongly supported by the NRA, the gun lobby's on his side.
Yeah,
they're running millions of dollars of ads against
firing at the redcoats.
And I regret that, because what I would like to see is for people to come together and say, of course, we're going to protect and defend the Second Amendment, but we're going to do it in a way that tries to save some of these 33,000 lives that we lose every year.
Let me bring Mr. Trump back into that, because, in fact, you oppose any limits on assault weapons, any limits on high-capacity magazines. You support a national right to carry law. Why, sir?
Well, let me just tell you, before we go any further, in Chicago, which has the toughest gun laws in the United States, probably you could say by far, they have more gun violence than any other city. So we have the toughest laws, and you have tremendous gun violence. I am a very strong supporter of the Second Amendment, and I am, I don't know if Hillary was saying it in a sarcastic manner, but I'm very proud to have the endorsement of the NRA, and it's the earliest endorsement they've ever given to anybody who ran for president. So I'm very honored by all of that. We are going to appoint justices. This is the best way to help the Second Amendment. We are going to appoint justices that will feel very strongly about the Second Amendment, that will not do damage.
Yeah, like Judge Scalia. Looks like we got a buffering issue here. There we go.
Well, let's pick up on another issue, which divides you and the justices that whoever ends up winning this election appoints could have a dramatic effect there, and that's the issue of abortion.
Right.
Mr. Trump, you're pro-life, but I want to ask you specifically,
Hillary's
do you
pro-killing
want the
babies.
Court, including the justices that you will name, to overturn Roe v. Wade, which includes, in fact, states a woman's right to abortion?
Well, if that would happen, because I am pro-life and I will be appointing pro-life judges, I would think that that will go back to the individual states.
But I'm asking you specifically, would you
if they overturned it, it'll go back to the states.
But what I'm asking you, sir, is do you want to see the court overturn? You just said you want to see the court protect the Second Amendment. Do you want to see the court overturn Roe v. Wade?
Well, if we put another two or perhaps three justices on, that's really what's going to be, that's will happen. And that'll happen automatically, in my opinion, because I am putting pro-life justices on the court. I will say this, it will go back to the states, and the states will then make a determination.
Well, I strongly support Roe v. Wade, which guarantees a constitutional right to a woman to make the most intimate, most difficult,
unborn.
In many cases, decisions about
beautiful
health care.
Beautiful thing, Hillary.
One
such a
imagine.
Good person.
And in this case, it's not only about Roe v. Wade. It is about what's happening right now in America. So many states are putting very stringent regulations on women that block them from exercising that choice to the extent that
and women should have the
defunding
right.
Planned
it's
Parenthood,
their
which
right.
Of course provides all kinds of cancer screenings and other benefits for women in our country. Donald has said he's in favor of defunding Planned Parenthood. He even supported shutting the government down to defund Planned Parenthood. I will defend Planned Parenthood. I will defend,
she'll defend killing
Roe v.
babies.
Wade, and I will defend women's rights to make their
to kill
own,
own
health
care
decisions.
Secretary
and we have come too far
human
to
beings.
Have that turn back now. And indeed, he said
she's
women should be punished, that there should
she
be some
wants America
form
to know about
of
it.
Punishment for women who obtain abortions. And I could just not be more opposed to that kind of thinking.
I'm going to give you a chance to respond, but I want
she's
to ask
pro-murder
you, Secretary
babies.
Clinton, I want to explore how far you believe the right to abortion goes. You have been quoted as saying that the fetus has no constitutional rights. You also voted against a ban on late-term partial birth abortions. Why?
That's sexy.
Because Roe v. Wade very clearly sets out that there can be regulations on abortion so long as the life and the health of the mother are taken into
Donald
account.
Trump drinks water funny. He's
and
like,
when I voted as a senator, I did not think that that was the case.
It's like a fish or something.
The kinds of cases that fall at the end of pregnancy are often the most heartbreaking, painful decisions for families to make. I have met with women who, toward the end of their pregnancy, get the worst news one could get, that their health is in jeopardy if they continue
and that's
to
true.
Carry
and there are
to
cases
term, or
that,
that something
through the cracks.
Terrible
Absolutely.
Has happened or just been
Absolutely.
Discovered about the pregnancy. I do not think the United States government should be stepping in and making those most personal of decisions. So
I don't think so either, but I don't agree with it.
If
you
are doing
so
with the life and the health of the mother taken into account.
Mr. Trump, your reaction, and particularly on this issue of late-term partial birth abortion.
Well, I think it's terrible. If you go with what Hillary is saying, in the ninth month, you can take the baby and rip the baby out of the womb of the mother just prior to the birth of the baby. Now, you can say that that's okay, and Hillary can say that that's okay, but it's not okay with me.
Yeah, me either.
Because based on what she's saying and based on where she's going and where she's been, you can take the baby and rip the baby out of the womb in the ninth month.
But Hillary's a good person. She's
and that's
pro baby killing.
Well, that is not what happens in these cases. And using
that kind
of
absolute murder
scare rhetoric is just
no, it's not. It's actually what happens. You kill a baby. That's what abortion is.
I've met with
killing.
Women I've known over the course of my life. This
she wants to engloss herself in her PC-ness right now. She's so PC.
Any woman in her family has to make.
Oh, that's fear rhetoric, Donald. No, no.
Should be making it. You know, I've had
we just press a button and the baby's disposed and flushed down the toilet. It's really clean. You don't even get your hands dirty.
Where governments either forced women to have abortions like they used to do in China or forced women to bear children like they used to do in Romania. And I can tell you the government has no business
talking points she had to study
in
up
the
on.
Decisions that women make with their families in accordance with their faith, with medical advice. And I will stand up for that right.
All right. But just briefly, I want to move on
and
to another
honestly,
segment.
Nobody has business doing what I just said, doing that as late as 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 days prior to birth. Nobody has that.
All right. Let's move on to the subject of immigration. And there is almost no issue that separates
Hillary's.
The two of you more
is
than the
seizure?
Issue of immigration.
Oh.
Actually, there are a lot of
almost.
Issues that separate the two of
almost.
You.
Almost.
Mr. Trump,
smile.
You want to
so
build
ugly.
A wall, Secretary
she
Clinton. You
teeth.
Have offered no
horrible,
specific plan for how you want to secure
God.
Our southern border.
A smoker.
Mr. Trump, you are calling for major deportations. Secretary Clinton, you say that
of
within
illegals.
Your first 100 days as president, you're going to offer
build a wall, Trump. Build a wall.
That includes
build
a
wall.
Pathway to citizenship. The question really is, why are you right and your opponent wrong? Mr. Trump, you go first in this segment. You have 2 minutes.
Well, first of all, she wants to give amnesty, which is a disaster and very unfair to all of the people that are waiting in line for many, many years. We need strong borders. In the audience tonight, we have 4 mothers of, I mean, these are unbelievable people that I've gotten to know over a period of years whose children have been killed, brutally killed by people that came into the country illegally. You have thousands of mothers and fathers and relatives all over the country. They're coming in illegally. Drugs are pouring in through the border. We have no country.
Yeah, but
if we
when
have
they become
no
citizens,
Hillary wants to give
they vote
amnesty.
Hillary
she
Clinton.
Wants to have open
so
borders.
That's why they want them here.
The border secure, as you know, the Border Patrol agent, 16,500 plus ICE last week endorsed me. First time they've ever endorsed a candidate. It means their job is tougher, but they know what's going on. They know it better than anybody. They want strong borders. They feel we have to have strong borders. I
we
was
do.
Up in New Hampshire the other day. The biggest complaint
secure.
They have, it's with all of the problems going on in the world, many of the problems caused by Hillary Clinton and by Barack Obama, all of the problems,
Andrew,
the single biggest problem
plus tenure
is heroin that pours across our southern borders, just pouring and destroying their youth. It's poisoning the blood of their youth and plenty of other people. We have to have strong borders. We have to keep the drugs out of our country. We are right now, we're getting the drugs, they're getting the cash. We need strong borders. We need absolute, we cannot give amnesty. Now, I want to build the wall. We need the wall. The Border Patrol, ICE, they all want the wall. We stop the drugs. We shore up the border. One of my first acts will be to get all of the drug lords, all of the bad ones. We have some bad, bad people in this country that have to go out. We're going to get them out. We're going to secure the border. And once the border is secured,
that's
at a later date,
like.
We'll make a determination as to the rest. But we have some bad hombres here, and we're going
to
get them
to the moderator there. Looked like a signal,
Mr.
didn't it?
Mr. Trump, thank
remember
you.
She was accused same about that before with Lester
Secretary
Holt.
Secretary Clinton,
what?
Basically,
odd.
Why are you right,
odd.
Mr. Trump is wrong?
Very
well,
odd. She
as he was
there.
Talking, I was thinking about a young girl I met here in Las Vegas, Carla. who was very worried that her parents might be deported. Because
that was the signal. See, that's the talking point right there. She probably has an earpiece in, although I can't see it because her hair is covering it. She did this to confirm when they told her to bring up this talking point. Like, hey, I got your message.
Sending parents away from children.
Or she messaged
them. I don't want to see the deportation force that Donald has talked about in action in our country. We have 11 million.
I don't want to see illegals coming over the border in action,
American
Hillary.
So
what do you have to say about that?
15 million people. He said as recently as a few weeks ago in Phoenix that every undocumented person would be subject to deportation. Now, here's what that means.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they
it
should be.
It means you would have to have
illegally.
A massive law enforcement presence, where law enforcement officers would be going school to school, home to home, business to business, rounding up people who are undocumented.
Liken it
and
to some kind of Gestapo
we would then have
tactic
to put them
or something.
On trains, on buses to get them out of our country. I think that is
it's pretty logical. You just board them up.
An idea that is not in
get the hell out of our country. You're illegal.
I think it's an idea that would rip our country apart. I have been for border security
illegal immigration
for years.
Is ripping
I voted
our country
for border
apart.
Security in the United States Senate. And my comprehensive immigration reform plan, of course, includes border security. But I want to put our resources where I think they're most needed, getting rid
to, like,
of
bailouts
any violent
and,
person,
the Clinton money
anybody
scam
who
foundation.
Should be deported. We should deport them. When it comes to the wall that Donald talks about building, he went to Mexico. He had a meeting with the Mexican president. Didn't even raise it. He
Hillary
choked.
Has a big wall
and
on
then
her
got
properties,
into a Twitter
the
war because
walls,
the Mexican president
armed,
said we're
armed
not
guards,
paying
security,
for that wall.
Secret Service.
So I think we are both
she's
a nation of
up,
immigrants
though,
and we are a nation
should.
Of laws and that we can act accordingly. And that's why I'm introducing comprehensive immigration reform within the first 100 days with a path to citizenship.
Thank you, Secretary
to
Clinton.
Vote Hillary Clinton and Democrat for the rest of eternity.
First of all, I had a very good meeting with the president of Mexico, very nice man. We will be doing very much better with Mexico on trade deals, believe me. The NAFTA deal signed by her husband's one of the worst deals ever made of any kind, signed by anybody. It's a disaster. Hillary Clinton wanted the wall. Hillary Clinton fought for the wall in 2006 or thereabouts. Now, she never gets anything done, so naturally the wall wasn't built. But Hillary Clinton wanted the wall.
Well, let me.
We
no,
are
wait,
a country
sir,
of
me,
laws.
Let
we
me,
either
let me,
have. And by the way,
I, no wait. I'd like to hear from.
Well, but
I'd like to hear
thing.
From. I'd like to hear from Secretary Clinton.
I voted for border security, and there are
and the wall.
Some. There are some limited places where that was appropriate. There also is necessarily going to be new technology and how best to deploy that. But it is clear when you look at what Donald has been proposing. He started his campaign bashing immigrants, calling Mexican immigrants rapists and criminals and drug dealers, that he has a very different view about what we should do to deal with immigrants. Now, what I am also arguing is that bringing undocumented immigrants out from the shadows, putting them into the formal economy, will be good because then employers can't exploit them and undercut Americans' wages. And Donald knows a lot about this. He used undocumented labor to build the Trump Tower. He underpaid undocumented workers, and when they complained, he basically said what a lot of employers do. You complain, I'll get you deported. I want to get everybody out of the shadows, get the economy working, and not let employers like Donald exploit undocumented workers, which hurts them, but also hurts American workers.
Mr. Trump.
President Obama has moved millions of people out. Nobody knows about it. Nobody talks about it. But under Obama, millions of people have been moved out of this country. They've been deported. She doesn't want to say that, but that's what's happened. And that's what's happened big league. As far as moving these people out and moving, we either have a country or we don't. We're a country of laws. We either have a border or we don't. Now, you can come back in and you can become a citizen. But it's very unfair. We have millions of people that did it the right way. They're online, they're waiting. We're gonna do citizens. Very unfair that somebody runs across the border, becomes a citizen. Under her plan, you have open borders, you would have a disaster on trade, and you will have a disaster with your open borders.
I wanna,
but
we,
what she doesn't say
is that President Obama has deported millions and millions of people just the way
Secretary Clinton, I want to...
We will not have open borders.
Well, that is a rank mischaracterization.
We will have secure borders, but we will also have reform. And this used to be a bipartisan issue. Ronald Reagan was the last president to sign immigration reform, and George W. Bush supported it as well.
Secretary Clinton, I want to clear up your position on this issue, because in a speech you gave to a Brazilian bank for which you were paid $225,000, we've learned from the WikiLeaks that you said this, and I want to quote, "My dream is a hemispheric common market with open trade and open borders." So that's
Thank
the
you.
Question.
Trump
That's the question. Please quiet everybody. Is that your dream, open borders?
Well, if you went on to read the rest of the sentence, I was talking about energy. You know, we trade more energy with our neighbors than we trade with the rest of the world combined. And I do want us to have an electric grid, an energy system that crosses borders. I think that would be a great benefit to us.
You are very clearly quoting
from WikiLeaks, and what's really important about
Russia
WikiLeaks
here.
Is that the Russian government has engaged in espionage against Americans.
Bullshit.
They have hacked American
websites,
American accounts
Bullshit.
Of private people, institutions, that information to WikiLeaks for the purpose of putting it on the internet. This has come from the highest levels of the Russian government.
What about your national spying agency that's spying illegally on Americans right now, Hillary?
17 of our intelligence agencies have confirmed to influence our election. So I actually think the most important question of this evening, Chris, is finally, will Donald Trump
admit? This bitch wants nuclear war, by the way, and you're going to get it with her.
And make it clear that he will not have the help of Putin in this election, that he rejects Russian espionage against Americans, which he actually encouraged.
I know her talking
past.
Points better than
Those
she does.
Those are the questions we need answered. We've never had anything like this happen
like
in any of our elections before.
That was a great pivot off the fact that she wants open borders.
Another signal? Okay. Another signal?
How did we get onto Putin?
There's another one right there.
Hold on, folks. Because this is going to end up getting out of control. Let's try to keep it quiet so
that'd be good.
And for the American people.
We want it to get out of control. That'd be awesome.
She wants open borders. People are going to pour into our
country. Signal.
People are going to come in from Syria. She wants 550% more people than Barack Obama. And he has thousands and thousands of people. They have no idea where they come from. And you see, we are going to stop radical Islamic terrorism in this country. She won't even mention the words, and neither will President
Obama.
Well,
she created it. That's what the Israeli Secret Intelligence Service is.
She wants open borders. Now we can talk about Putin. I don't know Putin. He said nice things about me. If we got along well, that would be good.
Yeah, it would be good. It prevents nuclear war and a Holocaust.
ISIS, that would be good. He has no respect for her. He has no respect for our president. And I'll tell you what, we're in very serious trouble.
He hates her,
because we have a country.
And it's not like Russia's our friend. They're not. And there is an intelligence war. I'm not disagreeing with that.
1,800, by the way, where they expanded and we didn't. 1,800 nuclear warheads, and she's playing chicken. Look, Putin, from everything I see, has no respect for this person.
Well, that's because he'd rather have a puppet as president of
no
the United
puppet.
States.
No
puppet.
No puppet.
Prefer not to have a whore
like you
in office.
You won't admit that
the
Russians have engaged in cyber attacks against the United States of America, that you encouraged espionage against our people, that you are willing to spout the Putin
line, sign
up for his wish list, break up NATO, do whatever he wants to do, and that you continue to get help from him because
she is so full of shit.
He has a very clear favorite in this race. So I think that this is such an unprecedented situation. We've never had a foreign government trying to interfere in our election. We have 17.
Are you kidding me? Of course. Everyone's always trying to interfere. That's what the intelligence war is.
Military who have all concluded that these espionage attacks,
they can be trusted. Yeah, we all trust them.
The highest levels of the Kremlin. and they are designed to influence our election.
See how the talking point is war, war, war? She wants war.
She has no idea whether it's Russia, China, or anybody else.
I am not quoting myself. I am quoting 17.
You have no idea.
17 intelligence. Do you doubt 17 military and civilian agencies? Well,
he'd
rather believe Vladimir Putin than the military and civilian intelligence professionals who are sworn to protect us. I find that just absolutely.
I mean, they're totally trustworthy.
Putin has outsmarted her at every step of the way. Excuse me. Putin has outsmarted her in Syria. He's outsmarted her every step of the way.
I do get to ask
some questions.
Keep talking,
Trump. That's awesome.
And I would like to ask you this direct question. The top national security officials of this country do believe that Russia has been behind these hacks. Even if you don't know for sure whether they are, do you condemn any interference by Russia in the American election?
By Russia or anybody else?
You condemn their interference?
Of course I can.
Well, we don't know they're interfering.
I don't know Putin. I have no idea.
You're assuming they're interfering. We do not know that.
This is not my best friend. But if the United States got along with Russia, wouldn't be so bad. Let me tell you, Putin has outsmarted her and Obama at every single step of the way, whether it's Syria, you name it, missiles. Take a look at the startup that they signed. The Russians have said, according to many, many reports, I can't believe they allowed
signal.
Us to do
Same
this.
One again.
They
Notice
create
that?
Warheads, and we can't. The Russians can't believe it. She has been outsmarted by Putin, and all you have to do is look at the Middle East. They've taken over. We've spent $6 trillion. They've taken over the Middle East.
500,000 people dead in Syria, by the way.
She has been outsmarted and outplayed worse than anybody I've ever seen in any government whatsoever.
We're a long way away from immigration, but I'm going to let you finish this topic.
Well,
you got about 45 seconds.
Yeah,
and she always will be.
I find it ironic that he's raising nuclear weapons. This is a person
Stein,
who has been very cavalier, even casual about the use of nuclear weapons. He's advocated more countries getting them, Japan, Korea, even Saudi Arabia. He said, well, if we have them, why don't we use them, which I think is terrifying. But here's the deal. The bottom line on nuclear weapons is that when the president gives the order, it must be followed. There's about 4 minutes between the order being given and the people responsible for launching nuclear weapons to do so. And that's why 10 people who have had that awesome responsibility have come out and in an unprecedented way said they would not trust Donald Trump with the nuclear codes or to have his finger on the nuclear
The only person I don't trust is you,
I have
Hillary.
200 and admirals, 21 endorsing me, 21 Congressional Medal of Honor recipients. As far as Japan and other countries, we are being ripped off by everybody in the world. We're defending other countries. We are spending a fortune doing it. They have the bargain of the century. All I said is we have to renegotiate these agreements because our country cannot afford to defend Saudi Arabia, Japan, Germany, South Korea, and many other places. We cannot continue to afford. She took that as saying nuclear weapons. Look, she's been proven to be a liar on so many different ways. This is just another lie.
Well, I'm just quoting you when
there's no quote. You're not going to find a quote from me.
Nuclear competition in Asia. You said, you know, go ahead, enjoy yourselves, folks. That kind
and defend
of language,
yourselves.
That, well,
and defend
United
yourselves.
States
I didn't say nuclear. And defend
the
yourself.
The United States has kept the peace through our alliances. Donald wants to tear up our alliances. I think it makes the world safer, and frankly, it makes the United States safer. I would work with our allies in Asia, in Europe, in the Middle East, and elsewhere.
There.
That's the only way we're going to be able to keep
the peace. We are going to move on to the next topic.
I think she confused herself there. I don't even
which is the economy, and I hope we handle that.
Oh, that's great. More bankster bailouts, Hillary? That'd be wonderful.
You also have very different ideas about how to get the economy growing faster. Secretary Clinton, in your plan,
0% interest rates to infinity and beyond.
You see more government spending, more
definitely more bailouts,
more tax credits, more tax penalties. Mr. Trump, you want to get government out with lower taxes and less regulation.
Yes.
We're going to drill down into this a little bit
that's
more.
A radical
but
idea.
In this overview, please explain to me why you believe that your plan will create more jobs and growth for this country and your opponent's plan will not. In this round, you go first, Secretary Clinton.
Well, I think when the middle class thrives, America thrives. And so my plan is based on growing the economy, giving middle-class families many more opportunities. I want us to have the biggest jobs program since World War II, jobs in infrastructure and advanced manufacturing. I think we can compete with high-wage countries, and I believe we should. New jobs and clean energy, not only to fight climate change, which is a serious problem, but to create new opportunities and new businesses. I want us to do more to help small business. That's where two-thirds of the new jobs are going to come from. I want us to raise the national minimum wage because
people
who live in poverty should not, who work full-time should not still be in poverty. And I sure do want to make sure women get equal pay for the work we do. I feel strongly that we have to have an education system that starts with preschool and goes through college.
An indoctrination
That's why I
system.
Want more technical education in high schools and in community colleges, real apprenticeships to prepare young people for the jobs of the future. I want to make college debt-free and for families making less than $125,000.
How do you do that? Raising prices.
You will not get a tuition bill from a public college or university if the plan that I worked on with Bernie Sanders is enacted. And we're going to work hard to make sure that it is, because we are going to go where the money is. Most of the gains in the last years since the Great Recession have gone to the very top. So we are going to have the wealthy pay their fair share. We're going to have corporations make a contribution greater than they are now to our country. That is a plan that has been analyzed by independent experts, which said that it could produce 10 million new jobs. By contrast, Donald's plan has been analyzed to conclude it might lose 3.5 million jobs. Why? Because his whole plan is to cut taxes, to give the biggest tax breaks ever to the wealthy and to corporations, adding $20 trillion to our debt and causing the kind of dislocation that we have seen before, because it truly will be trickle-down economics on steroids. So the plan I have, I think, will actually produce greater opportunities. The plan he has will cost us jobs and possibly lead to another great recession.
Secretary, thank you. Mr. Trump, why will your plan create more jobs and growth than Secretary Clinton?
Well, first of all, before I start on my plan, her plan is going to raise taxes and even double your taxes. Her tax plan is a disaster. And she can say all she wants about college tuition. And I'm a big proponent. We're going to do a lot of things for college tuition, but the rest of the public's going to be paying for it. We will have a massive, massive tax increase under Hillary Clinton's plan. But I'd like to start off where we left, because when I said Japan and Germany, and I'm not to single them out, but South Korea, these are very rich, powerful countries, Saudi Arabia, nothing but money. We protect Saudi Arabia. Why aren't they paying? She immediately, when she heard this, I questioned it. And I questioned NATO. Why aren't the NATO questioned? Why aren't they paying? Because they weren't paying. Since I did this, this was a year ago, all of a sudden they're paying. And I've been given a lot of credit for it. All of a sudden they're starting to pay up. They have to pay up. We're protecting people. They have to pay up. And I'm a big fan of NATO, but they have to pay up. She comes out and said, we love our allies. We think our allies are great. Well, it's awfully hard to get them to pay up when you have somebody saying, we think how great they are. We have to tell Japan in a very nice way. We have to tell Germany, all of these countries, South Korea, we have to say, you have to help us out. We have, during his regime, during President Obama's regime, our national debt. We're up to $20 trillion. So my plan, we're going to renegotiate trade deals. We're going to have a lot of free trade. We're going to have free trade, more free trade than we have right now. But we have horrible deals. Our jobs are being taken out by the deal that her husband signed, NAFTA, one of the worst deals ever. Our jobs are being sucked out of our economy. You look at all of the places that I just left. You go to Pennsylvania, you go to Ohio, you go to Florida, you go to any of them. You go upstate New York. Our jobs have fled to Mexico and other places. We're bringing our jobs back. I am going to renegotiate NAFTA. And if I can't make a great deal, then we're going to terminate NAFTA and new deals. We're going to have trade. But we're going to terminate it. We're going to make a great trade deal. And if we can't, we're going to do it. We're going to go a separate way because it has been a disaster. We are going to cut taxes massively. We're going to cut business taxes massively. They're going to start hiring people. We're going to bring the $2.5 trillion that's offshore back into the country. We are going to start the engine rolling again, because right now our country is dying at 1% GDP.
Well, let me translate that if I can, Chris, because
you can't.
The fact is, he's going to advocate for the largest tax cuts we've ever seen, three times more than the tax cuts under the Bush administration. I have said repeatedly throughout this campaign, I will not raise taxes on anyone making $250,000 or less. I also will not add a penny to the debt. I have costed out what I'm going to do. He will, through his massive tax cuts, add $20 trillion to the debt. Well, he mentioned the debt. We know how to get control of the debt. When my husband was president, we went from a $300 billion deficit to a $200 billion surplus, and we were actually on the path to eliminating the national debt. When President Obama came into office, he inherited the worst economic disaster since the Great Depression. He has cut the deficit by two-thirds. So, yes, one of the ways you go after the debt, one of the ways you create jobs is by investing in people.
Or
so
just defaulting,
I do have investments in new jobs, investments in education, skill training, and the opportunities for people to get ahead and stay ahead. That's the kind of approach that will work. Cutting taxes on the wealthy, we've tried that. It has not worked the way that it has been
promised.
Secretary
Clinton, I want to pursue your plan because in many ways it is similar to the Obama stimulus plan in 2009. Which has led to the slowest GDP growth since 1949.
And the debt doubling under his administration.
Thank you, sir. You told me in July when we spoke that the problem is that President Obama didn't get to do enough in what he was trying to do with his stimulus. So is your plan basically even more of the Obama stimulus?
Well, it's a combination, Chris. And let me say that when you inherit the level of economic catastrophe that President Obama inherited, it was a real touch-and-go situation. I was in the Senate before I became Secretary of State. I've never seen people as physically distraught as the Bush administration team was because of what was happening to the economy. I personally believe that the steps that President Obama took saved the economy. He doesn't get the credit he deserves for taking very hard positions.
Created more debt.
But it was
terrible
recession.
Bailing out
so
his
now
friends?
We've dug ourselves
the
out
Oracle
of it.
Bailouts.
We're standing, but we're not yet
Warren
running.
Buffett.
So what I am proposing is that we invest from the middle out and the ground up, not the top down. That is not going to work. That's why what I have put forward doesn't add a penny to the debt, but it is the kind of approach that will enable more people to take those new jobs, higher-paying
jobs.
We're beginning
jobs have been
to
lost
see
thanks
some
to Obamacare.
Increase in incomes. And we certainly have had a long string of increasing jobs. We've got to do more to get the whole economy moving, and that's what I believe I will be able to do.
Mr. Trump, even conservative economists who have looked at your plan say that the numbers don't add up, that your idea, and you've talked about 25 million jobs created, 4%
over a 10-year period
growth, is unrealistic. And they say, you talk a lot about growing the energy industry, they say with oil prices as low as they are right now, that's unrealistic as well. Your response?
So I just left some high representatives of India. They're growing at 8%. China is growing at 7%, and that for them is a catastrophically low number.
Well,
we are growing.
Are
our last report
well,
came out, and it's right around the 1% level, and I think it's going down. Last week,
more
as
like
you know, at the end of last week,
that's grown,
they came out
that's
with
good.
An anemic jobs report, a terrible jobs report. In fact, I said, is that the last jobs report before the election? Because if it is, I should win easily. It was so bad. The report was so bad. Look, our country is stagnant. We've lost our jobs. We've lost our businesses. We're not making things anymore, relatively speaking. Our product is pouring in from China, pouring in from Vietnam, pouring in from all over the world. I've visited so many communities. This has been such an incredible education for me, Chris. I've gotten to know so many. I've developed so many friends over the last year. And they cry when they see what's happened. I passed factories that were thriving 20, 25 years ago. And because of the bill that her husband signed and she blessed 100%, it is just horrible what's happened to these people in these communities. Now, she can say that her husband did well, but boy, did they suffer as NAFTA kicked in, because it didn't really kick in very much, but it kicked in after they left. Boy, did they suffer. That was one of the worst things that's ever been signed by our country. Now she wants to sign Trans-Pacific Partnership, and she wants it
She lied when she said she didn't call it the gold standard in one of the debates. She totally lied. She did call it the gold standard, and they actually fact-checked, and they said I was right. I was so honored.
I want to give you a chance to briefly speak to
She's
that.
A liar,
I want to pivot to one
thing,
which is Obamacare. But go ahead, briefly.
First, let me say, number one, when I saw the final agreement for TPP, I said I was against it. It didn't meet my tests. I've had the same tests.
Flip-flop.
Does it create jobs, raise incomes, and further our national security? I'm against it now. I'll be against it after the election. I'll be against it when I'm president. There's only one of us on this stage who's actually shipped jobs to Mexico, because that's Donald. He's shipped jobs to 12 countries, including Mexico. But he mentioned China. And, you know, one of the biggest problems we have with China is the illegal dumping of steel and aluminum into our markets. I have fought against that as a senator. I've stood up against it as Secretary of State. Donald has bought Chinese steel and aluminum. In fact, the Trump Hotel right here in Las Vegas was made with Chinese steel. So he goes around with crocodile tears about how terrible it is. But he has given jobs to Chinese steel workers, not American steel workers.
And Americans.
That's the kind of approach.
It's called a free market economy,
you dumb bitch. We're going to pull the country together. We're going to have trade agreements that we enforce.
Capitalism,
that's why
I don't know if you ever heard of it.
A trade prosecutor for the first time in history. And we're going to enforce those agreements. And we're going to look for businesses to help us by buying American products.
I ask a simple question. She's been doing this for 30 years. Why the hell didn't you do it over the last 15, 20 years? You were very much involved. Excuse me. My turn. You were very much involved in every aspect of this country. Very much. And you do have experience. I say the one thing you have over me is experience, but it's bad experience, because what you've done has turned out badly. For 30 years, you've been in a position to help.
She just agreed.
And
did
you say
like,
that
yeah,
I use
right.
steel or I use something else? I make it impossible for me to do that. I wouldn't mind. The problem is you talk, but you don't get anything done, Hillary. You don't. Just like when you ran the State Department, $6 billion was missing. How do you miss $6 billion? You ran the State Department. $6 billion was either stolen. They don't know. It's gone.
$6 billion. This is money laundering. You know, I'll take it, get rid of it.
If you become president, this country is going to
They need to
be
ask about the voter fraud situation. They haven't gotten to that yet. They need to ask about that. It's probably the biggest bombshell.
The State Department is not only untrue, it's been debunked numerous times. But I think it's really an important issue. He raised the 30 years of experience. So let me just talk briefly about that. You know, back in the 1970s, I worked for the Children's Defense Fund, and I was taking on discrimination against African-American kids in schools. He was getting sued by the Justice Department for racial discrimination in his apartment buildings. In the 1980s, I was working to reform the schools in Arkansas. He was borrowing $14 million from his father to start his businesses. In the 1990s, I went to Beijing, and I said, women's rights are human rights. He insulted a former Miss Universe, Alicia Machado, called her an eating machine. And on the day when I was in the Situation Room monitoring the raid that brought Osama bin Laden to justice, he was hosting the Celebrity Apprentice. So I'm happy to compare my 30 years of experience, what I've done for this country, trying to help in every way I could, especially kids and families, get ahead and stay ahead, with your 30 years, and I'll let the American people make that decision.
Well, I think I did a much better job. I built a massive company, a great company, some of the greatest assets anywhere in the world, worth many, many billions of dollars, $1 million loan. But I built a phenomenal company. And if we could run our country the way I've run my company, we would have a country that you would be so proud of. You would even be proud of it. And frankly, when you look at her real record, take a look at Syria. Take a look at the migration. Take a look at Libya. Take a look at Iraq. She gave us ISIS because her and Obama created this huge, huge vacuum, because when we should have never been in Iraq, but once we were there, we should have never got out the way they wanted to get out. She gave us ISIS as sure as you are sitting there. And what happened is now ISIS is in 32 countries. And now I listen how she's going to get rid of ISIS. She's going to get rid of nobody.
Yeah, why would she do that?
We are going to get to foreign hotspots.
Co-founder.
In a few moments, but the next segment is fitness to be president of the United States. Mr. Trump, at the last debate, you said your talk about grabbing women was just that, talk, and that you'd never actually done it. And since then, as we all know, 9 women have come forward and said that you either groped them or kissed them without their consent. Why would so many different women from so many different circumstances over so many different years, why would they all make up these stories? And since this is a question for both of you, Secretary Clinton, Mr. Trump says what your husband did and that you defended was even worse. Mr. Trump, you go first.
Well, first of all, those stories have been largely debunked. Those people, I don't know those people. I have a feeling how they came. I believe it was her campaign that did it. Just like if you look at what came out today on the clips, where I was wondering what happened with my rally in Chicago and other rallies where we had such violence. She's the one in Obama that caused the violence. They hired people, they paid them $1,500, and they're on tape saying, be violent, cause fights, do bad things. I would say the only way, because those stories are all totally false, I have to say that. And I didn't even apologize to my wife, who's sitting right here, because I didn't do anything. I didn't know any of these women. I didn't see these women. These women, the woman on the plane, the woman, I think they want either fame or her campaign did it. And I think it's her campaign.
The woman on the plane donates to Hillary Clinton's campaign, by the way.
What they did,
small amount,
which is a criminal act, by the way, where they're telling people to go out and start fistfights and start violence. And I'll tell you what, in particular in Chicago, people were hurt and people could have been killed in that riot. And that was now all on tape, started by her. I believe, Chris, that she got these people to step forward. If it wasn't, they get their 10 minutes of fame. But they were all totally, it was all fiction. It was lies and it was fiction.
Well,
Secretary Clinton.
At the last debate, we heard Donald talking about what he did to women. Have come forward saying that's exactly what he did to them.
Are you going to ask the same question about
response?
Her husband?
Well, he held a number of big rallies where he said that he could not possibly have done those things to those women because they weren't enough for
I did not say that.
In fact, he went on to say...
Her 2 minutes.
But did not say that.
It's her 2 minutes.
He went on to say, look at her. I don't think so. About another woman, he said, that wouldn't be my first choice. He attacked the woman reporter writing the story, called her disgusting, as he has called a number of women during this campaign. Donald thinks belittling women makes him bigger. He goes after their dignity. There is a woman anywhere who doesn't know what that feels like. So we now know what Donald thinks and what he says and how he acts toward women. That's who Donald is. I think it's really up to all of us to demonstrate and who our country is. And to stand up
and
be very clear about what we expect from our next president, how we want to bring our country together, where we don't want to have pitting of people one against the other.
Not quite an Oscar performance,
where instead
but pretty
we celebrate
good. She's
our
obviously
diversity,
been coached a little bit
we
on
lift
acting.
People
she got
up,
a little better.
And we make our country even greater. And it really is up to all of us to make that true. Now and in the future, and particularly for our children and our grandchildren.
Mr. Trump.
Nobody has more respect for women than I do. Nobody. Nobody has more respect.
Please, everybody.
And frankly, those stories have been largely debunked. And I really want to just talk about something slightly different. She mentions this, probably or possibly started by her and her very sleazy campaign. But I will tell you, what isn't fictionalized are her emails, where she destroyed 33,000 emails
criminally.
Hey, you read it in all the papers.
Mm-hmm. I read it.
Going to potentially serve 5 years in jail for lying to the FBI. One lie. She's lied hundreds of times.
Thousands.
To the people, to Congress, and to the FBI. He's going to probably go to jail. This is a 4-star general.
Mm-hmm. Well,
and
Petraeus
she gets away with it,
so.
And she can run for the presidency of the United States.
So
that's really what
herself.
You should be talking about, not fiction, where somebody wants fame or where they come out of her crooked campaign.
Secretary Clinton.
Well, crooked Hillary.
Every time Donald is pushed on something, which is obviously uncomfortable, like what these women are saying, he immediately goes to denying responsibility. And it's not just about women. He never apologizes or says he's sorry for anything. But he also went after a disabled reporter, mocked and mimicked him on national television.
Got to bring that one up again.
He went after Mr. and Mrs. Khan, the parents of a
Khan job.
Young man who died.
His son died because Hillary Clinton voted for the Iraq War,
because of their religion. He went after John McCain, a prisoner of war, said he prefers people who aren't captured. He went after a federal judge born in Indiana, but who Donald said couldn't be trusted to try the fraud and racketeering.
Not
one thing. This is a pattern of divisiveness, of a very dark and in many ways dangerous vision of our country, where he incites violence, where he and pulling. That is not
That's
who
bullshit.
America is. And I hope that as we move in the last weeks of this campaign, more and more people will understand what's at stake in this election. It really does come down to what kind of country we are going to have.
So sad when she talks about violence at my rallies, and she caused the violence. It's on tape. The other things are false, but honestly, I'd love to talk about getting rid of ISIS, and I'd love to talk about other things.
Okay.
But those other charges, as she knows, are false.
In this bucket about fitness to be president, there's been a lot of developments over the last 10 days.
I don't agree with it, but Hillary was really strong in that segment.
About them. These are questions that the American people have. Secretary Clinton, during your 2009 Senate confirmation hearing, you promised to avoid even the appearance of a conflict of interest with your dealing with the Clinton Foundation while you were Secretary of State. But emails show that donors got special access to you. Those seeking grants for Haiti relief were considered separately from non-donors,
and
some of those donors got government contracts, taxpayer money. Can you really say that you kept your pledge to that Senate committee, and why isn't what happened and what went on between you and the Clinton Foundation, why isn't it what Mr. Trump calls pay to play?
Well, everything I did as Secretary of State was in furtherance of our country's interests and our values.
Your interest,
the State Department has said that. I think that's been proven. But I am happy.
You're a money
In fact,
whore.
I'm thrilled to talk about the Clinton Foundation because it is a world-renowned charity. And I am so proud of the work that it does. You know, I could talk for the rest of the debate. I know I don't have the time to do that. But just briefly, the Clinton Foundation made it possible for 11 million people around the world with HIV/AIDS to afford treatment. And that's about half of all the people in the world who are getting treatment.
Totally deflecting this
question. In partnership with the American Health Association, we have made environments in schools healthier for kids,
Secretary Clinton,
healthier
respectfully, this is an open discussion.
Well, it is an open discussion.
I have a specific question.
But there is a lot of evidence about the very good work
and it's a
and
criminal
the high
enterprise,
that
and
the
so many people
let Mr.
know
Trump
it. It's a criminal enterprise. Saudi Arabia giving $25 million, Qatar,
they treat women like shit,
all of these
by the
countries. You talk about women
feminist.
And women's rights. So these are people that push gays off business, off buildings. These are people that kill women and treat women horribly, and yet you take their money. So I'd like to ask you right now, why don't you give back the money that you've taken from certain countries
that treat
certain groups of people so horribly? Why don't you give back the money? I think it would be a great gesture.
Well,
because the people of Haiti, I was at a little Haiti the other day in Florida, and I want to tell you, they hate the Clintons, because what's happened in Haiti with the Clinton Foundation is a disgrace, and you know it. And they know it, and everybody knows
Secretary
it.
Well,
Clinton.
Very quickly, we at the Clinton Foundation spend 90% of all the money that is donated on behalf of programs of people around the world and in our own country.
Not for
I'm very
Haiti,
proud
though.
Of that.
It was
we have 5%. The highest rating from the watchdogs that follow foundations. And I'd be happy to compare what we do with the
Who
Trump Foundation,
the
which took
you.
Money from other people and bought a six-foot portrait of Donald. I mean, who does that? It just was astonishing. But when it comes to Haiti, Haiti is the poorest country in our hemisphere. The earthquake and the hurricanes, it has devastated Haiti. Bill and I have been in tears. The Clinton Foundation raised $30 million to help Haiti after the catastrophic earthquake and all of the terrible problems the people there had.
Why do they hate
you? We've done things to help small businesses, agriculture, and so much else. And we're going to keep working to help Haiti because it's an important part of the American
They don't want you to help them anymore.
I'd
like to mention one thing. Trump Foundation, small foundation. People contribute. I contribute. The money goes 100%. 100% goes to different charities, including a lot of military. I don't get anything. I don't buy boats. We put up the American flag, and that's it. They put up the American flag. We fought for the right in Palm Beach to put up the American flag.
There was a penalty that was imposed by Palm Beach County.
There
and
was.
The money came
there was,
from your foundation.
And by the way, the money,
instead of Mar-a-Lago,
the money
yourself,
went
sir.
To Fisher House, where they build houses. The money that you're talking about went to Fisher House, where they build houses for veterans and disabled
I want to get into one
but
last...
But, of course, there's no way we can know whether any of that is true because he hasn't released his tax returns. He is the first candidate
exactly
ever to run for president
and
in
he
the
did
last 40-plus years, who has not released his tax returns. So everything he says about charity or anything else, we can't prove it. You can look at our tax
Hillary's
returns.
Doing well.
We've
I mean,
got
she
them
is.
All out there. But what is really troubling... is that we learned in the last debate he has not paid a penny in federal income tax. And we were talking about immigrants a few minutes ago, Chris. You know, half of all immigrants, undocumented immigrants in our country, actually pay federal income tax. So we have undocumented immigrants in America who are paying more federal income tax than a billionaire. I find that
astonishing. So let me just tell you very
simply.
We're entitled, because of the laws that people like her pass, to take massive amounts of depreciation and other charges, and we do it. And all of her donors, just about all of them, I know Buffett took hundreds of millions of dollars. George Soros took hundreds of millions of dollars. Let me just explain. Most of her donors have done the same thing as I did.
And
you know what you should have done?
Folks, we heard
and
this
you know, Hillary, what you should have done? Okay. You should have changed the law when you were a United States senator. If
folks,
you don't like
we heard
it,
this.
Because you take in so much money. I mean, I sat in my apartment today on a very beautiful hotel down the street, known as
Trump. Made with Chinese.
We didn't even
but
know
I will
detail.
Tell you, I sat there watching ad after ad after ad, false ad, all paid for by your friends on Wall Street that gave so much money because they know you're going to protect them. And frankly, you should have changed the laws. If you don't like what I did, you should have changed the laws.
Mr. Trump, I want to ask you about one last question in this topic. You have been warning at rallies recently that this election is rigged and that Hillary Clinton is in the process of trying to steal it from you. Your running mate, Governor Pence, pledged on Sunday that he and you, his words, will absolutely accept
Hillary
the result of this
signaler.
Election. Today, your daughter Ivanka said the same thing. I want to ask you here on the stage tonight, do you make the same commitment that you will absolutely, sir, that you will absolutely accept the result of this?
I'm not looking. It's so bad. First of all, the media is so dishonest and so corrupt, and the pile-on is so amazing. The New York Times actually wrote an article about it that they don't even care. It's so dishonest, and they've poisoned the minds of the voters. But unfortunately for them, I think the voters are seeing through it. I think they're going to see through it. We'll find out on November 8th, but I think they're going to see through it.
But, sir, there's
a... If you look, excuse me, Chris, if you look at your voter rolls, you will see millions of people that are registered to vote. Millions. This isn't coming from
that
me.
Are dead.
This is coming from Pew Report and other places. Millions of people that are registered to vote that shouldn't be registered to vote. So let me just give you one other thing. So I talk about the corrupt media. I talk about the millions of people. I'll tell you one other thing. She shouldn't be allowed to run. She's guilty of a very, very serious crime. She should not be allowed to run. And just in that respect, I say it's rigged because she should never have been allowed to run for the presidency based on what she did with emails and so many other things.
But it's a peaceful transition of power, and that no matter how hard fought a campaign is, that
it
at
might
the
not
end
be
of the
peaceful
campaign,
this time.
That The loser concedes to the winner, not saying that you're necessarily going to be the loser or the winner, but that the loser concedes to the winner and that the country comes together in part for the good of the country. Are you saying you're not prepared now to commit to that principle?
What I'm saying is that I will tell you at the time. I'll keep you in suspense.
Well, okay? Chris, let me respond to that because that's horrifying. You know, every time Donald thinks
you're
things are not going in his direction, he claims whatever it is rigged against him. The FBI conducted a year-long investigation into my emails. They concluded there was no case. He said the FBI was rigged. No. He lost the Iowa caucus. He lost the Wisconsin primary. He said the Republican primary was rigged against him. Then Trump University gets sued for fraud and racketeering. He claims the court system was rigged against him. There was even a time when he didn't get an Emmy for his TV program 3 years in a row, and he started tweeting that the Emmys were rigged against
him. Should have gotten it.
This is a mindset.
That's awesome.
This is how Donald thinks. And it's funny, but it's also really troubling.
Okay.
No, that is not the way our democracy works. We've been around for 240 years. We've had
free
and fair elections.
Thanks to you.
We've accepted the outcomes when we may not have liked them. And that is what must be expected of anyone standing on a debate stage during a general election. You know, President Obama said the other day, when you're whining before the game is even finished, it just shows you're not up to doing the job. And let's be clear about and what that means. He is denigrating, he's talking down our democracy. And I, for one, am appalled that somebody who is the nominee of one of our two major parties would take that kind of...
This works in her favor, by the way.
FBI, with her husband, the attorney general, in the back of an airplane on the tarmac in Arizona, I think it's disgraceful.
Phoenix, Sky Harbor.
All right. I think we've never had a situation
Hold on, folks. This doesn't do any good for anyone. Let's please continue the debate and let's move on to the subject of foreign hotspots. The Iraqi offensive to take back Mosul has begun. The question then becomes, what happens the day after? And that's something that whoever of you ends up as president is going to have to confront. Will you put U.S. troops into that vacuum to make sure that ISIS doesn't come back or isn't replaced
by
something even worse?
Hillary won't put troops there, she'll just drop a nuke.
Secretary Clinton, you go first in this segment. You have 2 minutes.
Well, I am encouraged that there is an effort led by the Iraqi army, supported by forces and also given the help and advice from the number of special forces and other Americans on the ground. But I will not support putting American soldiers into Iraq as an occupying force. I don't think that is in our interest, and I don't think that would be smart to do. In fact, Chris, I think that would be a big red flag waving for ISIS to reconstitute itself. The goal here is to take back Mosul. It's going to be a hard fight. I've got no illusions about that. And then continue to press into Syria to begin to
take back and move on Raqqa, which is the ISIS headquarters.
I am hopeful that the hard work that American military advisors have done
will
pay off.
We will see a really successful military operation, but we know we've got lots of work to do.
Syria will remain a hotbed of terrorism as long as the civil war, aided and abetted by the Iranians and the Russians, continue. So I have said, look, we need to keep our eye on ISIS. That's why I want to have an intelligence surge that protects us here at home, why we have to go after them from the air, on the ground, online, why we have to make sure here at home we don't let terrorists buy weapons. If you're too dangerous to fly, you're too dangerous to buy a gun. And I'm going to continue to push for a no-fly zone and safe havens within Syria, not only to help protect the Syrians and prevent the constant outflow of refugees, but to frankly gain some leverage on both the Syrian government and the Russians so that perhaps we can have the kind of serious negotiation necessary to bring the conflict to an end and go forward on a political track.
Mr. Trump, same question. If we are able to push ISIS out of Mosul and out of Iraq, would you be willing to put U.S. troops in there to prevent their return or something else?
Let me tell you, Mosul's so sad.
We had Mosul. But when she left, when she took everybody out, we lost Mosul. Now we're fighting again to get Mosul. The problem with Mosul and what they wanted to do is they wanted to get the leaders of ISIS, who they felt were in Mosul. About 3 months ago, I started reading that they want to get the leaders, and they're going to attack Mosul. Whatever happened to the element of surprise, okay? We announced we're going after Mosul. I've been reading about going after Mosul now for about, how long
has it been? Kind of rehashing things we've heard before here.
These people have all left. They've all left. The element of surprise. Douglas, MacArthur, George, Patton, spinning in their graves when they see the stupidity of our country. So we're now fighting for Mosul that we had. All she had to do is stay there. Now we're going in to get it. But you know who the big winner in Mosul is going to be after we eventually get it? And the only reason they did it is because she's running for the office of president. And they want to look tough. They want to look good.
Yeah, he's right.
He violated the red line in the sand.
Charade.
And made so many mistakes. Made all mistakes. That's why we have the great migration. But she wanted to look good for the election. So they're going in. But who's going to get Mosul, really? We'll take Mosul eventually. By the way, if you look at what's happening, much tougher than they thought. Much, much tougher, much more dangerous, going to be more deaths than they thought. But the leaders that we wanted to get are all gone because they're smart. They say, what do we need this for? So Mosul is going to be a wonderful thing, and Iran should write us a letter of thank you, just like the really stupid, the stupidest deal of all time, a deal that's going to give Iran absolutely nuclear weapons. Iran should write us yet another letter saying thank you very much. Because Iran, as I said many years ago, Iran is taking over Iraq, something they've wanted to do forever, but we've made it so easy for them. So we're now going to take Mosul, and you know who's going to be the beneficiary? Iran. Boy, are they making...
Final
I mean,
target.
They are outsmarting...
I've done many videos on that.
Look, you're not there. You might be involved in that decision,
one
but you were there when
demand.
You took everybody
below,
out of Mosul and out of Iraq. You shouldn't have been in Iraq, but you did vote for it. You shouldn't have been in Iraq, but once you were in Iraq, you should have never left the way. The point is, the big winner is going to be Iran.
Well, you know, once again, Donald is implying that he didn't support the invasion of Iraq. I said it was a mistake. I've said that years ago. He has consistently denied what is a very clear fact that before the invasion, he supported it. And, you know, I just want everybody to go Google it. Google Donald Trump Iraq, and you will see the dozens of sources which verify that he was for the invasion of Iraq.
Wrong.
And you can actually hear the audio of him saying that. Now, why does that matter? Well, it matters because he has not told the truth about that position. I guess he believes it makes him look better now, to contrast with me, because I did
vote for it, Hillary.
But what's really important here is to understand all the interplay. Mosul is a Sunni city. Mosul is on the border of Syria. And yes, we do need to go after Baghdadi, and just like we went after bin Laden. While you were doing Celebrity Apprentice, and we brought him to justice. We need to go after the leadership, but we need to get rid of them, get rid of their fighters. They're estimated several thousand fighters in Mosul. They've been digging underground. They've been prepared to defend. It's going to be tough fighting, but I think we can take back Mosul, and then we can move on into Syria and take back Raqqa. This is what we have to do. I'm just amazed that he seems to think that the Iraqi government and our allies and everybody else launched the attack on Mosul to help me in this election. But that's how Donald thinks, you know. He always is looking for some
Chris,
conspiracy.
We don't gain anything.
He has all the
Iran is taking over Iraq.
Secretary Clinton.
Iran is taking over Iraq. We don't gain
anything.
Which he's been spewing
out. We would have gained if they did it by surprise. We would have gained
now,
if they did it by
Secretary,
surprise.
Secretary, please let Mr. Trump speak.
He's unfit, and he proves it every time
You
he
are
talks.
The one that's unfit. You know, WikiLeaks just actually came out. John Podesta said some horrible things about you, and boy, was he right. He said some beauties. And, you know, Bernie Sanders, he said you have bad judgment. You do. And if you think that going into Mosul, after we let the world know we're going in, and all of the people that we really wanted, the leaders, they're all gone. If you think that was good, then you do. Now, John Podesta said you have terrible instincts. Bernie Sanders said you have bad judgment. I agree with both.
Well, you should ask Bernie Sanders who he's supporting for president, and he has said, campaigned for me around the country, you are the most dangerous person to run for president in the modern history of America. I think he's right.
Let's turn to Aleppo. Mr. Trump, in the last debate, you were both asked about the situation in the Syrian city of Aleppo, and I want to follow up on that because you said several things in that debate which were not true, sir. You said that Aleppo has basically fallen. In fact, there are...
It's a catastrophe.
It's a catastrophe, but there are a quarter...
Have you seen it? Have you seen what's happened to Aleppo?
If I might finish my question.
Okay, so it hasn't fallen. Take a look at it.
Well, there are a quarter of a million people still living there and being slaughtered.
That's right.
They
are being slaughtered because of bad decisions.
If I may just finish here. And you also said that ISIS, that Syria and Russia are busy fighting ISIS. In fact, they have been the ones who've been bombing and shelling eastern Aleppo, and they just announced a humanitarian pause, in effect admitting that they have been bombing and shelling Aleppo. Would you like to clear that up, sir?
Well, Aleppo is a disaster. It's a humanitarian nightmare, but it has fallen from the from any standpoint. I mean, what do you need, a signed document? Take a look at Aleppo. It is so sad when you see what's happened. And a lot of this is because of Hillary Clinton. Because
I'm curious to see if they shake hands.
By fighting Assad,
I give it a 50-50
who turned out
coin
to be
flip.
A lot tougher than she thought.
But
and now she's going to say, oh, he loves Assad.
Probably yes, but
she's
God,
just,
I hope
he's
no.
just much tougher and much smarter than her and Obama. And everyone thought he was gone. He aligned with Russia. He now also aligned with Iran, who we made very powerful. We gave them $150 billion back. We give them $1.7 billion in cash. I mean, cash, bundles of cash.
Gut instinct says, I don't think Trump's
winning this
debate. We gave them
$1.7 billion. Now, they have aligned. He has aligned with Russia and with Iran. They don't want ISIS, but they have other things because we're backing rebels.
It's not that I don't agree.
We don't know who the rebels are.
It's not that I necessarily agree with that. It's that
lots of money, lots of everything.
How
we
I know
don't
the American
know who
people
the rebels are. And when and if, and it's not going to happen because you have Russia and you have Iran now, but if they ever did overthrow Assad, you might end up with as bad as Assad is, and he's a bad guy. But you may very well end up with worse than Assad. If she did nothing, we'd be in much better shape. And this is what's caused the Great Migration, where she's taken in tens of thousands of Syrian refugees who probably, in many cases, not probably, who are definitely, in many cases, ISIS-aligned. And we now have them in our country. And wait till you see, this is going to be the great Trojan horse. And wait till you see what happens in the coming years. Lots of luck, Hillary. Thanks a lot for doing a great job.
Secretary Clinton, you have talked about, and in the last debate and again today, that you would impose a no-fly zone to try to protect the people of Aleppo and to stop the killing there. President Obama has refused to do that because he fears it's going to draw us closer or deeper into the conflict. And General Joseph Dunford, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, says, you impose a no-fly zone, chances are you're going to get into a war, his words, with Syria and Russia. So the question I have is, if you impose a no-fly zone, first of all, how do you respond to their concerns? Secondly, if you impose a no-fly zone and a Russian plane violates that, does President Clinton shoot that plane down?
Well, Chris, first of all, I think a no-fly zone could save lives and could hasten the end of the conflict. I am well aware of the really legitimate concerns that you have expressed
Russia
from both the president
act.
And the general. This would not be done just on the first day. This would take a lot of negotiation. It would also take making it clear to the Russians and the Syrians that our purpose here was to provide safe zones on the ground. We've had millions of people leave Syria, and those millions of people inside Syria who've been dislocated. So I think we could strike a deal and make it very clear to the Russians and the Syrians that this was something that we believe was in the best interests of the people on the ground in Syria. It would help us with our fight against ISIS. But I want to respond to what Donald said about refugees. He's made these claims repeatedly. I am not going to let anyone into this country who is not vetted, who we do not have confidence in, but I am not going to slam the door on women and children. That picture of that little four-year-old boy in Aleppo with the blood
Total
coming
propaganda.
Down his face while he sat in an ambulance is haunting. And so we are going to do very careful, thorough vetting. That does not solve our internal challenges with ISIS and our need to stop radicalization, to work with American Muslim communities who are on the front lines to identify and prevent attacks. In fact, the killer of the dozens of people at the nightclub in Orlando, the Pulse nightclub, was born in Queens, the same place Donald was born. So let's be clear about what the threat is and how we are best going to be able to meet it. And yes, some of that threat emanates from over in Syria and Iraq, and we've got to keep fighting, and I will defeat ISIS. And some of it is we have to up our game and be much smarter here
Folks,
at home.
I want to get into our final segment.
But I just have to, it's
Real
so
quick.
Ridiculous what you, she will defeat ISIS. We should have never let ISIS happen
ISIS.
In the first place. And right now they're in 32 countries.
Okay.
You should have never. Wait one second. They had a ceasefire 3 weeks ago. A ceasefire, United States, Russia, Syria.
Mm-hmm. All true.
And during the ceasefire, Russia took over vast swatches of land. And then they said, we don't want the ceasefire anymore. We are so outplayed on missiles, on ceasefires. They are outplayed. Now, she wasn't there. I assume she had nothing to do with it. But our country is so outplayed by
okay.
Putin and Assad and, by the way, and by Iran. Nobody can believe how stupid our leadership is.
Mr. Trump, Secretary Clinton,
we
need to move on to our final segment, and that is the national debt, which has not been discussed until tonight. Our national debt as a share of the economy, our GDP, is now 77%. That's the highest since just after World War II. But the Nonpartisan Committee for a Responsible Federal Budget says, Secretary Clinton, under your plan, debt would rise to 86% of GDP over the next 10 years. Mr. Trump, under your plan, they say it would rise to 105% of GDP over the next 10 years. Question is, why are both of you ignoring this problem? Mr. Trump, you go first.
Well, I say they're wrong because I'm going to create tremendous jobs. And we're bringing GDP from really 1%, which is what it is now. And if she got in, it'll be less than zero. But we're bringing it from 1% up to 4%, and I actually think we can go higher than 4%. I think you can go to 5 or 6%. And if we do, you don't have to bother asking your question, because we have a tremendous machine. We will have created a tremendous economic machine once again. To do that, we're taking back jobs. We're not going to let our companies be raided by other countries where we lose all our jobs. We don't make our product anymore. It's very sad. But I'm going to create the kind of a country that we were from the standpoint of industry. We used to be there. We've given it up. We've become very, very sloppy. We've had people that are political hacks making the biggest deals in the world, bigger than companies. You take these big companies, these trade deals are far bigger than these companies. And yet we don't use our great leaders, many of whom back me and many of whom back Hillary, I must say. But we don't use those people. Those are the people. These are the greatest negotiators in the world. We have the greatest business people in the world. We have to use them to negotiate our trade deals. We use political hacks. We use people that get the position because they made a campaign contribution. And they're dealing with China and people that are very much smarter than they are. So we have to use our great people. But with that being said, we will create an economic machine the likes of which we haven't seen in many decades. And people, Chris, will again go back to work, and they'll make a lot of money, and we'll have companies that will grow and expand and start from new.
Secretary Clinton.
Well, first, when I hear Donald talk like that and know that his slogan is Make America Great Again, I wonder when he thought America was he error. I think it's important to recognize that he has been criticizing our government for decades. You know, back in 1987,
that's very American.
He took out a $100,000 ad in the New York Times during the time when President Reagan was president, and basically said exactly what he just said now, that we were the laughing stock of the world. He was criticizing President Reagan. This is the way Donald thinks about himself, puts himself into you know, the middle and says, you know, I alone can fix it, as he said on the convention stage. But if you look at the debt, which is the issue you asked about, Chris, I pay for everything I'm proposing. I do not add a penny to the national debt. I take that very seriously because I do think it's one of the issues we've got to come to grips with. So when I talk about how we're going to pay for education, how we're going to invest in infrastructure, how we're going to get the cost of prescription drugs down, and a lot of the other issues that people talk to me about all the time, I've made it very clear we are going where the money is. We are going to ask the wealthy ever that that will slow down or diminish our growth. In fact, I think just the opposite. We'll have what economists call middle-out growth. We've got to get back to rebuilding the middle class, the family America. That's where growth will come from. That's why I want to invest in you. I want to invest in your family. And I think that's the smartest way to grow the economy, to make the economy fairer. And we just have a big disagreement about this. It may be because of our experiences. You know, he started off with his dad as a millionaire. I started off with my dad as a small businessman.
We've heard this before.
I think it's, like it's, you know, it's a difference that affects how we see the world and what we want to do with the economy.
Tom.
Thank you, Hillary. Could I just respond?
Well, no.
Because I disagree with Ronald Reagan very strongly on trade. I disagreed with him. We should have been much tougher on trade even then. I've been waiting for years. Nobody does it right. And frankly, now we're going to do it right.
All right. The one last area I want to get into with you in this debate is the fact that the biggest driver of our debt is entitlements, which is 60% of all federal spending. Now, the Committee for Responsible Federal Budget has looked at both of your plans, and they say neither of you has a serious plan that is going to solve the fact that, Medicare is going to run out of money in the 2020s, Social Security is going to run out of money in the 2030s, and at that time, recipients are going to take huge cuts in their benefits. So, in effect, the final question I want to ask you in this regard is, and let me start with you, Mr. Trump, would President Trump make a deal to save Medicare and Social Security that included both tax increases and benefit cuts, in effect, a grand bargain on entitlements?
I'm cutting taxes. We're going to grow the economy. It's going to grow at a record rate.
But that's not going to help on entitlements.
It's going to totally help you. And one thing we have to do, repeal and replace the disaster known as Obamacare. It's destroying our country. It's destroying our businesses, our small business, and our big businesses. We have to repeal and replace Obamacare. You take a look at the kind of numbers that that will cost us in the year 17. It is a disaster if we don't repeal and replace. Now, it's probably going to die of its own weight, but Obamacare has to go. The premiums are going up 60, 70, 80%. Next year, they're going to go up over 100%. And I'm really glad that the premiums have started. At least the people see what's happening, because she wants to keep Obamacare and she wants to make it even worse. And it can't get any worse. Bad health care at the most expensive price. We have to repeal and replace Obamacare.
And Secretary Clinton, same question, because at this point, Social Security and Medicare are going to run out. The trust funds are going to run out of money. Will you, as president, consider a grand bargain, a deal that includes both tax increases and benefit cuts to try to save both programs?
Well, Chris, I am on record as saying that we need to put more money into the Social Security Trust Fund. That's part of my commitment to raise taxes on the wealthy. My Social Security payroll contribution will go up, as will Donald's, assuming he can't figure out how to get out of it. But what we want to do is to replenish the Social Security Trust Fund by making sure that we have sufficient resources. And that will come from either raising the cap and or finding other ways to get more money into it. I will not cut benefits. I want to enhance benefits for the current Social Security system. But what Donald is proposing with these massive tax cuts will result in a $20 trillion additional national debt. That will have dire consequences for Social Security and Medicare. And I'll say something about the Affordable Care Act, which he wants to repeal. The Affordable Care Act extended the solvency of the Medicare Trust Fund. So if he repeals it, our Medicare problem gets worse. What we need to do is go after the long-term health care drivers. We've got to get costs down, increase value, emphasize wellness. I have a plan for doing that, and I think that we will be able to get entitlement spending under control with more resources and smarter decisions.
This is the final time, probably to both of your delight, that you're going to be on the stage together in this campaign.
Thank God.
I would like to end it on a positive note. You had not agreed to closing statements, but it seems to me in a funny way that might make it more interesting because you haven't prepared closing statements. So I'd like you each to take it. We're going to put a clock up a minute.
But we know she's prepared.
As the final question in the final debate to tell the American people
that's bullshit, man.
Why they
Hillary knows it's coming
to be the next
Trump
president.
Probably doesn't
this
know.
This is another new mini segment.
Bullshit.
Secretary Clinton, it's your turn to go first.
Well, I would like to say to everyone watching tonight that I'm reaching out to all Americans, Democrats, Republicans, and Independents, because we need everybody to help make our country what it should be, to grow the economy, to make it fairer, to make it work for everyone. We need your talents, your skills, your commitment, your energy, your ambition. You know, I've been privileged to see the presidency up close, and I know the awesome responsibility of protecting our country and the incredible opportunity of working
it's
to try to make life better for all of you.
Think about it.
I have made the cause of children and families really my life's work. That's what
she's
my mission will be in the presidency. I will stand up for
I
families against powerful
That's
interests,
awesome.
Against
so.
Corporations.
I
will
that.
Do everything that I can to make sure that you have good jobs
right
with rising incomes, that your Maybe kids
you
have good educations from preschool through college. I hope you will give me a chance to serve as your president.
Secretary Clinton,
no,
thank you.
I won't.
Mr. Trump.
Sorry.
She's raising the money from the people she wants to control. Doesn't work that way. But when I started this campaign, I started it very strongly. It's called Make America Great Again. We're going to make America great. We have a depleted military. It has to be helped, has to be fixed. We have the greatest people on earth in our military. We don't take care of our veterans. We take care of illegal immigrants, people that come into the country illegally better than we take care of our vets. That can't happen. Our policemen and women are disrespected. We need law and order, but we need justice too. Our inner cities are a disaster. You get shot walking to the store. They have no education. They have no jobs. I will do more for African Americans and Latinos than she can ever do in 10 lifetimes. All she's done is talk to the African Americans and to the Latinos. But they get the vote, and then they come back. They say, we'll see you in 4 years. We are going to make America strong again, and we are going to make America great again, and it has to start now. We cannot take 4 more years of Barack Obama, and that's what you get when you get
her.
Let me
do the handshake. Donald Trump
Thank
should go.
Thank you both. Secretary Clinton, hold on just a moment, folks. Secretary Clinton, Mr.
Smile.
Trump, I want to thank you both for participating in all three of these debates. That brings to an end this year's debate, sponsored by the Commission on Presidential Debates.
Sponsored by
we
George
want to
Soros.
Thank the University of Nevada, Las Vegas,
and its Foundation.
Students for having us. Now the decision is up to you. While millions
it
have
is,
already
really.
Voted, Election Day, November 8th, is just 20 days away. You can agree on, we hope you will go vote. It is one of the honors and obligations of living in this great country. Thank you, and good night.
Okay, looking for the handshake here. Let's see what happens. This out here. I don't see it yet. Ooh, to shake that. All right, folks, that's it. I'm Christopher Green. We're going to let this process get it out, viral, hard-hitting, and in your face. I've got analysis coming. Peace.